Good morning, folks.
Good morning.
You're very welcome to our service this morning. It's good to see you out. The weather's changing a wee bit, a bit damp this morning. If you're visiting with us this morning, you're very welcome, and we hope you stay along for a cup of tea or coffee afterwards in the cafe area. There's just one or two announcements for this evening, or for your notes. Most of the stuff, obviously, is in the weekly sheet, but just one or two things to point out. Remind you about tonight's service at 6:30 p.m. It's down here, and it'll be in the cafe area. There's a committee meeting tomorrow night, so all members of committee, note there's a meeting tomorrow night at 7:30 p.m. in the meeting room. And you'll notice in your announcement sheet this morning, there's a wee survey about music at Strand. Grateful if you could fill that in. And there's a small box sitting close to the sink there in the cafe area. So if you'd fill this in and pop it into the box, just to give us an idea about music, on your thoughts on music, and what sort of type you like, whether you rock and roll or whatever it's going to be, okay? So Ian promised us both rock and roll this morning, and so we're going to hand over to Ian now for our first item of worship.
I don't know if you've ever watched the film The Blues Brothers. Anybody ever watch it? And the Blues Brothers were playing at their first venue, and it was a country and western venue, and these guys were playing rock and roll, and they asked them, "Well, sir, what type of music do you play?" And he says, "We play both types, country and western." And so we play both types, rock and roll. Come on, we'll stand and we'll sing, not a rock and roll song, but "When Peace Like a River."
All my sin, all this glory.
Let's turn to God in prayer. Let's pray. Father, thank you that you have brought each of us safely to this place. We gladly surrender our lives to you in worship and praise. As we gather, we remember those who are not with us today. For those who are sick, we ask for healing. And for those away from us, we ask for your blessing to be on them. We invite your Holy Spirit to move freely amongst us. Come dwell in each of our hearts. Equip us, challenge us, comfort us, teach us. Inspire us as we learn more about your majestic ways. Father, as we meet now, may we behold your beauty and encounter your grace. We ask all this in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen. Going to turn to God's Word now. We're going to read just a couple of verses. And we're doing this theme of looking through the Bible in 16 verses. So we're going to look at Genesis chapter 3, and that's verses 6 and 7. When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked, so they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. Amen. I don't think there are actually any children out to go out to Sunday at this children's church this morning, so or to Sunday panel. So we'll carry on, Ian. Just pass over to you again for some more praise. Thank you.
It's a great song which focuses totally on God and His precious Son, Jesus. Come on, we'll stand and sing, Holy, Holy, Holy. Oh,
I think unless you've been living in a cocoon this week, you've noticed a lot of stuff going on over in Parliament in London. Lots of different things. Nobody knows really what's going to happen. You may have also read in the local papers about the civil servants are starting to think about what to do if there's no Brexit. And I'm being moved jobs just to move into a wee small team that's going to be looking at what do we do if there's a no Brexit thing. So lots of preparations are going on. There's even talk about fuel shortages and manning pumps and giving out certain tickets to people who are essential users and all sorts of things. And I came across this morning or during the week there. It's a prayer. It was posted up and it was being asked for churches to pray about Brexit, basically. And I thought I would use that this morning for our prayer. It was written by the Reverend Dr. Martin Johnston, who's secretary to a church and society council of the Church of Scotland. And he was encouraging churches across the UK to use this prayer. So with that in mind, let's pray. Let's turn to God. God, who in Jesus broke down all barriers between people of different races, rich and poor, male and female, Jew and Gentile, between heaven and earth, we worship you. God, at this time of heavy responsibility, as decisions about future relationships with our neighbours in Europe are being taken, we pray for our leaders, that they will lead wisely, that they will listen attentively, that they will exercise grace, and that they will know peace in their deliberations. God, at this time of uncertainty, within our nations and communities, we pray for ourselves that we will remain open to the stranger, welcoming to the neighbour, and committed to those who struggle. God, we pray for your church of which we are a part, that we might be a place of honest reflection, respectful dialogue, open friendship, humility, and reconciliation. We pray that we might be a community that points to heaven and shows ways in which heaven is glimpsed on earth. God, who in Jesus breaks down all barriers between people of different races, rich and poor, male and female, Jew and Gentile, between heaven and earth, we worship you. Amen. Yeah.
So before Martin comes to speak to us, we're going to sing two songs. One of them we're going to stand and sing, the other one we're going to sit down and sing. Very un-Presbyterian, I know that, but sure, who cares? And first one's just a great song. I just love to sing it, and it's called Jesus is the Name We Honor. Come on, we'll stand and we'll sing.
Just a game of baffles.
Again on Jesus as the King of Kings, and what a faithful God he is. So it's called Faithful One, and we'll sing this one, although we're sitting, we'll sing this one as a prayer. God, we just thank you for who you are. We thank you for what you've done. We thank you that you're the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and you love us with a passion, and that's why we'll come to worship you this morning. Faithful One.
So, as we continue to look at the Bible in 16 verses, we've looked so far at the creation of the world and the creation of humankind. We have seen how the Bible records the creation in chapter 1, verse 31 says, God was pleased with all he had created. It was very good. And last week, Danny talked about the specific creation of humankind. He looked at how it differs from the rest of creation. We are made in God's own image. We bear his likeness in our physical aspect, and we also have a spiritual aspect to us, what we call our soul. And both of these aspects of our creation set us apart from everything else. And, like the rest of creation, God made man good. He did not create a depraved man. And one of the points of Genesis chapter 2 is to point out that God provided for man everything he needed to make his life rich and happy. And he was bountiful to his special creation, and he wasn't begrudging about it. And so with this special creation comes a special relationship, a covenant relationship between mankind and God. I talked before about the five covenants that God had with man, starting with Noah, Abraham, and so on. But there was also a covenant between God and Adam. And you can read it in chapter 2 of Genesis. It sets out there a condition for obedience. Don't eat the fruit. There's a threat of a curse in the event of failure to obey. And a clear implication of blessing is promised for obedience. And so in our short reading this morning in verses 6 and 7, we see the action of disobedience and the immediate consequence for both Adam and Eve. They both eat the fruit, and then their eyes are opened, and they are immediately ashamed. So this morning, let's look around these two verses, see how this happened, and what the consequences are, both for those two individuals and for us today. So first, we have the devil at his work. We don't know how the devil does this, but he disguises himself as one of God's lower creatures, and he talks to Eve. He smuggles in the assumption that God's word is up for debate. And again, if you've been watching any of the news, any of the debates that have been going on in the House of Commons, you'll notice that there are points of view for basically everything, different points of view for every subject. And it really is confusing. I mean, if you watch and you go, right, one guy says this, he's got the same information and he's made this conclusion. And this person over here has got the same information and made a different conclusion. And when you listen to their arguments, they all sound plausible and you just don't know what's what. So we can imagine what's going on here in this debate between the serpent and between the devil and Eve. Debate, discussion, maybe, you know, different points of view. So you can imagine what that one might be like. But his aim here is to weaken, to degrade and destroy man by seducing him from the righteousness with which he was created. And so Eve's response. Unfortunately, Eve does a couple of things wrong here in her response. First of all, she minimizes God's generosity. When God spoke to them about what they could eat and what they couldn't eat, God told them that every tree in the garden is available to eat except this one. But Eve fails to state this in her response. She doesn't say it's every tree. She just said, yeah, we're allowed to eat stuff in the garden, but not that tree. So she really minimizes what God had provided for her. She fails to acknowledge the abundance of God's love and what he has provided for her and for them. But she also, as well as taking away from God's word, she also adds to God's word. In her response, she adds that touching the fruit itself would cause death. But God never ever said that. And she also removes the note of certainty. God's statement of punishment was absolute. You will certainly die, he says. But Eve left that certainty out in her statement back to Satan. Which then casts a whole note of doubt to the whole threat. Is it real? Is it not real? How strong is it going to be? You know yourself, sometimes as a parent, you've threatened to punish your kids with something, but they end up maybe not doing it just as strong as you initially promised to do. And so this note of doubt is cast into that threat. And so with that in mind, with Eve's response, and the devil obviously has picked up on some of these things that she's maybe not quite got things right, he presses on. And he goes on by contradicting God's warning of judgment. Already encouraged by her response, he recognizes that she's got a couple of things wrong. He pushes on, casting more doubt on the consequences of eating the fruit. And very cleverly, he never actually says, "Sure, go on, why don't you take a bite?" He simply just casts the doubt, and her own thoughts and her own mind does the rest. He also implies that God is stingy. He's put into her head that God is withholding some benefits from them by suggesting other positive consequences of eating the fruit, such like they would become like God. He offers them enrichment and enlightenment because being godlike, they would know good and evil. Now, the philosopher Nietzsche is reputed to have said this: "If there are gods, who could endure not being one?" In other words, if there are gods, why can't we be gods too? Why do they have all the glory about it all? Why can't we be gods? That's what he was saying. And it does sound enticing, but what it really meant for Eve and Adam was the ability to determine for oneself what is good and evil, what is helpful and what is harmful. And throughout the Bible, we read various passages about what that means. In Genesis chapter 3, verses 5 and 22, we read that God has this ability to know between good and evil, between right and wrong. In 1 Kings 3, verse 9, Solomon prays for this knowledge of good, this knowledge so that he can rule well. In Deuteronomy 1, verse 39, we're told that little children don't yet have the ability to know the difference between good and evil. And in 2 Samuel 19, verse 35, we read that older people start to lose this ability. This knowledge of good and evil, therefore, refers to the capacity and the right to decide for oneself what is good and what is bad, what's helpful and what is harmful. Therefore, what God was forbidding was not simply a piece of fruit, but what the fruit symbolized. To eat of the tree of knowledge of good and evil would mean to reject God and the all-wise, all-caring Father who knows what is good for us, and in his place to put ourselves. So then we have Adam and Eve's sin. So all this conversation is going on with Eve, and she takes a bite, and then she seems to pass it to Adam. But we realize, probably, we don't maybe necessarily realize sometimes in reading that Adam was actually right beside her the whole time. We always tend to blame Eve for giving into the temptation first, then enticing Adam. Yet in verse 6, after taking a bite, she simply turned around to Adam and offered him a bite. He wasn't elsewhere off in the garden. He was standing right beside her, and he was listening to the whole thing. Yet he never pitched in. He never said it, never said anything. He never offered to correct her when she maybe got something wrong on what she said about what God promised him. And in the original language, we note that plural pronouns are used about this. So we do know that it does indicate that they were both standing there at the time, listening to the conversation. And really the heart of Adam's sin then is really lawless rebellion. Essentially, this suggests that Adam maybe already felt a wee bit like this. He felt aggrieved possibly at this one rule. And he did feel the temptation to taste the fruit. And this really conversation really just pushed him on a wee bit and went a long way to settling his mind to take that bite. And in their sin, Satan's agenda was simply to turn God's entire created order on its head. When God created order in this world, he created it's God first. So you've got God, you've got Adam and Eve, and the creatures and the rest of creation. And Satan's agenda was to turn all that around. He wanted a creature, basically himself, at the top, with man, with humankind, Adam and Eve there, and God's word at the bottom, because he said it was imperfect and it was destructive, and that was what he was trying to create. And so simply, all his words were well-crafted lies to seed doubt into their minds about what God expected from them. And so then, having done all that, we'll look to then the tragic consequences. First of all, what happened to Adam and Eve? Well, the most obvious consequence of the fall is the radical change in man's attitude towards God. Overwhelmed with a sense of guilt and shame, Adam and Eve hide themselves from the face of their Maker. Having previously read about them wandering in the garden and discussing with God and chatting with him, now they're hiding from him. Made in and for the fellowship of God, they now flee from him who is their source of highest good. Their eyes, we read, were opened and they were naked, and they hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God in the trees. A second consequence of the fall then is God's attitude to man. Where there had been harmony, now there is a note of rebuke struck. Man hears the reproving questions. Who told you you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree? Here we perceive that the divine character in a new aspect, his righteous anger expressing itself in condemnation and a curse. A curse which does not remove the privileges and responsibilities with which man is created, but rather embitters him. Motherhood is now fraught with pain. Work has toil and perspiration, and the relationship between man and woman is marred by tyranny and abject submission. And thirdly, then, man's entire environment is perverted by his sin. The very ground is affected adversely. Cursed is the ground for your sake, in Genesis 3:17. And as Paul says when he writes to the Romans, the whole creation groans with pain, like the pain of childbirth. I'm saying also as a result of the fall, then man is marked for death. The threat that he should suffer the wage of sin, which is death, is now carried out. The warning that they should defy the divine prohibition and eat the forbidden fruit, they would die, becomes a reality for our first parents. And banished from the garden with its tree of life, they and we, their offspring, face the fearful prospect of returning to the ground from where we came. So what's the consequences for Adam and Eve? What about everybody else? Well, the consequences that they suffered as a result of their disobedience continues on to us. And this is known as the doctrine of original sin. That's the key doctrine of our church. Scripture tells us that our first parents failed the test, and as a result, they and we, their offspring, are confirmed in sin, a fate from which only the grace of God can deliver us. Romans 5, verse 12. Sin came into the world through one man, and his sin brought death with it. As a result, death has spread to the whole human race because everyone has sinned. And so, like Adam and Eve, our attitude to God is all wrong. We also are full of guilt and shame, and we love to hide in the darkness rather than living out in the light. Like Adam and Eve, God's attitude to us has changed. We live under the curse of the law, condemned, because we cannot achieve the standards that the law require. And like Adam and Eve, our environment remains cursed forever. We will toil and struggle. And like Adam and Eve, we are marked for death, not just physical death, but spiritual. When we talked about our soul at the beginning of our service this morning, our soul lives on, but it calls about a second death, which is forever out of the presence of God. But there is hope. So that's our two verses this morning, and there's quite a lot contained, I suppose, to talk about in those two verses. And it does leave us with a bleak picture, but for one thing. Looking back to Romans chapter 5 again, where Paul talks about Adam, there is also good news. He continues in verse 17. It is true that through the sin of one man, death began to rule because of that one man. But how much greater is the result of what was done by the one man, Jesus Christ? All who receive God's abundant grace and are freely put right with him will rule in life through Christ. So then, as the one sin condemned all people, in the same way the one righteous act sets all people free and gives them life. And just as all people were made sinners as a result of the disobedience of one man, in the same way they will all be put right with God as a result of the obedience of the one man. So hopefully then we'll come to that more in due course. It'll be one of the verses that we look at, one of the 16, about God's plan for redemption. But for now, for this morning, simply be encouraged that by trusting in Christ, we are free from this condemnation of sin now and forever. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for your word, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that we can read your word freely, Lord, and openly, and discuss it, Lord, and study it. Lord, as we look at these verses this morning, we realize, Lord, how sin entered the world, Lord, and how we have been corrupted, Lord, by that sin and continue to be corrupted throughout our whole lives, Lord. And we read that without you, Lord, without your grace, without your glory, without the death of your Son Jesus, Lord, we cannot achieve, Lord, what needs to be done, Lord, to come back to you, to reconcile that relationship. And so we just pray, Lord, that we thank you for his death, Lord, on the cross, and we just pray that you'd be with us as we continue to strive, Lord, to seek your face, to understand you more and more as we follow you, Lord, each week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We'll continue our worship this morning with our offering.
Clear explanation this morning. Thank you. We're going to finish our service with this is one of they're all my favorites, aren't they? I just picked my favorites this year. That's okay. I can do that. This is How Deep the Father's Love. I hope it's one of your favorites too. I just love it. Come on, we'll stand and sing.
Thank you. I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, no wisdom. But I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer. But this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my
the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forevermore. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.